And my message this morning is I can't see myself. That's the title of the message that the Lord has given me. He gave it to me a few weeks back, and I've been really wanting to preach it, but He gave me the go-ahead now. And we're going to start off reading out of Matthew chapter 23. And the essence, you know, my problem as a preacher is that I feel like God puts a lot of things in my heart, and I really try to keep it like one concept, one thought, but I have a difficult time staying reined in because I feel like sometimes even as I'm preaching, the Lord gives me things and I feel like He wants me to say it. Amen. Some other preachers would say, oh no, man, you're just kind of going off on your own. I'm not here to argue with them. I'm just here to say, I want to give the Lord liberty to say whatever He is going to say. Amen. So should the Lord have His liberty and take over this message, and I don't even say what I thought I was going to say, I want you to know that what I'm really trying to communicate this morning is that when God changes us, something, for some reason, there's a spirit connected to what I'm trying to talk to you about. We're going to focus a little bit here in Matthew 23 about the Pharisees. And what I want you to see about the way the Pharisees acted was that there was a spirit on them. But the sad thing is that same spirit that was on them, somehow that doggone thing tries to jump on Christians. And the same way they acted is the same way we start to act. We start thinking we got something figured out. And all of a sudden we can't see our own self anymore. Oh, we can see everybody else real clear. I can see the blemishes on your face. I can see all the things in your life. But for some reason, I can't see myself. Now, for you, you know, who maybe are not familiar with this thought, you know, we always try to have a little bit of Sunday school mixed up in our message, and some of you already are familiar with this, but there were two groups of people during the time frames of Jesus. There, the two main groups were the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They made up what you call the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was a religious group of religious leaders. Now, there were some people in the Sanhedrin who ended up getting saved. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Amen. Nicodemus is the one in John chapter 3 that went at nighttime. Now, John doesn't do that on accident. When John says he was walking in the darkness of night, he means, and if you read the context, Nicodemus didn't know. Jesus told him, you be the teacher of Israel and you know not these things. In other words, I'm trying to talk to you about what it means to be born again. You know what it means to be born again, right? Amen. That God has a plan. Come on, somebody. It's okay if we tell the truth in the church today. Sometimes the truth hurts, but we need to hear it because that's the way God wrote it. Mankind is separated from the presence of God because of the sin that is in him. But once again, God has a plan. He sent his son Jesus to die on the cross. And when you put your faith in that, do you realize that there are multitudes out there that don't know what I'm about to tell you? Something as simple as this. And I know that it's true because last week I spoke to at least four of them at work. Just opening up conversation and talking to people who are in the midst of turmoil and chaos in their life, and begin to, they're open to hearing, and they don't even know what it means to really be born again. That God sent Jesus, the sinless one, the eternal Lamb of God, to die on a cross. Why? So that he could bear the sins of humanity upon his person because he was sinless. And then he gave his life in your place and in my place through the shedding of his blood and the giving of his life. And now whenever ears hear that gospel meaning good news, and receive it by faith, embrace it from the heart, not intellectually. I make a big point about this, and you'll probably hear me repeat myself about some things, and I hope that's okay, because I want to get it in our spirit. I'm not talking about just believing intellectually or cognitively, not just being able to understand in your mind the things that we're talking about, but instead embracing from the heart. The inner man says, yes, God, I believe that this is true, that I was born a sinner of Adam, but that in order to be born again, I must embrace the last Adam, whose name is Jesus, and what he did for me on the cross. You may not need to know all that when you first get saved. I've told you my story before, right? In a little church, man. That's why when you were singing about that song, old church, that little bitty church, I was thinking about Sister Tut, and I was thinking about all these little churches, and people nowadays in the modern church, they make fun of little churches. Oh, you ain't got nothing going on in your church. Hold on a second. Do you realize how many true conversions have taken place in little bitty old small country churches? Hallelujah. Whatever the preacher that was obedient to just tell the truth, and now whenever that hurting heart began to feel the Holy Spirit move upon it, and they would respond by faith, that they would receive life on the inside of them, and that they'd stand up Well, the Pharisees didn't understand that. I need you to know that there was a Sanhedrin. It was a religious people. But Nicodemus, he was one. He heard it. He was walking at night. He didn't understand what it meant to be born again. But Jesus told him, essentially, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. See, the first time you were born of your mother, you were born of Adam, you were born in sin. You must be born of the Spirit. Faith in the blood of the Lamb causes a spiritual birth to take place on the inside of your heart. You can't talk about it through logic. You can try to have a logical conversation with somebody who's maybe intelligent, but their logical mind cannot wrap around or comprehend the spiritual essence of what the gospel teaches. It's something that must be embraced by faith. And if you will embrace this truth by faith, that miracle takes place in your heart. And if it's happened to you, you know what I'm talking about, because if it's happened to you, you can't comfortably just live in the old way you want to. I'm not saying you can't still do it. I'm saying you cannot comfortably do it. There's a constant nagging on the inside that's telling you something's not right.
Amen.
Well, but the majority of these Pharisees were antagonistic towards Jesus. You understand? They were full of religious pride. They did not believe. Do you understand that for thousands of years, and I know we've talked about this before, but for thousands of years, God had been communicating through the scriptures that he was sending the promised one. It's very clear. Let there be no mistake. God's been very clear. And I know that, I shouldn't even say that. I've said this before. I keep repeating myself on that. Let's just preach the gospel, right?
Amen.
Let's not apologize for telling
Amen.
The truth over
Amen.
And over. That God has one plan. Amen. And you can sum it up as simple as saying that the plan, I'm going to turn this air conditioner down because I'm getting hot. Are y'all hot?
Yeah.
It's 65 degrees in here, man. And I don't think that the air conditioner is going to come. But anyway, I tried to turn it on. I turned the heater on this morning. That's probably the problem. All right, well, anyway, here we go. We'll just cut that out of the video. Sorry y'all had to deal with it. The point is that God's had one plan of salvation. Amen? And in this plan, it could be summarized as simple, or make a synopsis, break it down, to something as simple as these two words, the seed and the sacrifice. That's God's plan. He's not changing his plan. He's staying focused on what he's doing. Mankind may not like God's plan. Mankind, even the church, may come up with their own groovy little new ideas and try to convince people who don't really know the word that this is now the new way to go. But the reality of it is that no, God's just moving along through the midst of salvation history, allowing his plan to come forward. The seed. In the garden incident, what we see is this. Man, God made man in his own image after his own likeness, and then man took sin into himself. He went the way of the serpent. Immediately, God brings forth the plan of redemption, and he gives a promise. And he says, the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. That was the first promise of the seed of the woman. But it wasn't just going to be the seed of the woman. But next, he told us in Genesis 12 that it would be the seed of Abraham. The seed of the woman, the seed of Abraham. This wasn't in my notes, but we're going here this morning. Amen. The seed of the woman, the seed of Abraham. But it wouldn't just be the seed of Abraham, but that instead it would also be the seed of David. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, the word of God says that there will be, when you go to sleep with your fathers, talking about you, David, when you die, King David, the greatest king that ever lived in Israel, that ever ruled and reigned from the throne of Israel, was David. He was a type of Christ. In 2 Samuel 7, he's getting old. God says, when you go to sleep with your fathers, I'm going to put another one upon your throne. He will rule for an eternity. His throne will be an eternal throne. There's certain passages in there that are talking about Solomon, but that one right there definitely ain't talking about Solomon. It's a prophetic utterance that speaks of the coming Messiah, the promised one who would sit on the throne of Israel for all of eternity. And listen, we got to back up a little bit. You need to put, if you take a note, you need to put one right above that right there, because I forgot one. In Genesis 49, the seed would come from Judah, the tribe of Judah. It says in that scripture in Judah, in Genesis 49, that the scepter, meaning the king's staff, would not depart from Judah until Shiloh comes. The word Shiloh in the Hebrew means to the one to whom it belongs. So it's the seed of the woman, the seed of Abraham, the seed of Judah, the seed of David. David came from the tribe of Judah. God's not missing anything here. He knows exactly what he's doing. He's dotting the I's and he's crossing the T's. Amen? Then the seed would be born of a virgin, we're told in Isaiah chapter 7. Then we're told in the New Testament was a crossover from the Old Covenant to the New Covenant. And John the Baptist is in the Jordan Valley and he's baptizing people. And here comes Jesus. We're actually going to look at that passage of scripture a little bit this morning. Here comes Jesus and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who taketh away the sin of the world." Now I don't want to get ahead of myself, because before I talk about him being the Lamb, I want to say this. The Word of God says in John chapter 1 that in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Jesus, the pre-incarnate Word, spoke the worlds into existence. Hallelujah. But then it says in verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelled amongst us. We're talking about the seed right now. So the seed has been promised all the way back in the garden incident that he was going to crush the head of the serpent. And here we see methodically God not moving it to the right or to the left, bringing that promise forward when the Word became flesh in Christ, incarnate, living upon the earth, the presence of God in him, the sacrifice. In the garden incident, whenever the fall took place, God clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of an animal. That animal had nothing to do with Adam and Eve's sin. See, mankind, just like Adam and Eve, still trying to sow fig leaves and cover the nakedness, the sinfulness of their own body, trying through the works of human flesh, just like the Pharisees, trying to find their own place of self-righteousness through the works of religion, through the works of man's hands. God says, that's not going to work. You can't cover sin with the works of your own hands. It requires a sacrifice, the shedding of blood. That innocent, that animal had nothing to do with Adam and Eve's sin, and yet God provided skins for them. Before that took place, there was never death upon the earth. Yes, the death took place spiritually when Adam and Eve ate, but then that was the first physical death that ever took place. God killed an animal, and he clothed the skin, clothed Adam and Eve to cover their sinfulness and their nakedness with the skins of an innocent animal. The sacrifice for the first couple that ever fell. Then in the book of Exodus, chapter 12, we see a sacrifice for a family at the Passover. Take a lamb, cut its throat, collect its blood, paint the doorposts and the sideposts with the blood. We see a progression taking place. The seed and the sacrifice. The Day of Atonement for Israel. Once a year on the Day of Atonement, a lamb, cut its throat, take its blood, apply it to the mercy seat. It will cover the sins of a nation. The sacrifice for a couple, the sacrifice for a family, the sacrifice for a nation. And then once again on the banks of the Jordan River, John the Baptist, "Behold the Lamb of God who taketh away the sin of the world." Hallelujah. God's got a plan, folks. And listen to me. Let me just say this real quick, because you know what? It's not really part of my message, but you know what? It's the gospel. And that's what I keep, and I'm going to keep reminding you of this. Because some people, I'm telling you, look, I've been doing this long enough that I've had a lot of people come against me. And it's okay. I mean, I expect people to come against me. And I don't have everything right. So you know what? Sometimes you need to come against me and we'll talk about it. But I know I'm right on this. Because people are going to be like, "Dude, you always talk about the cross." Exactly. The climax of human history. God's been working towards it. Listen to me. You know, the Lord gave me this one day whenever I was studying. And this is what the Lord showed me. This is why we don't leave this place. I know. We got to do something about this right here. It's a beautiful thing for the musician. Amen. And we'll just put it right back where it goes afterwards. Is that okay? I know that sometimes these things are sacred. In the Old Testament, I got sacred things too. In the Old Testament, the Word of God is getting Messiah to humanity. He's getting Messiah to humanity. Amen? Amen. You know what that means? It means that God said, not only did he promise that the seed would come through Abraham, but he promised Abraham that he'd become a nation. And that ultimately, through Abraham, we know the story, right? He had a son named Isaac. Isaac had Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. Jacob's name was changed to Israel when he wrestled with God on his journey to go get his wife. Amen. And the 12 sons became the 12 tribes of Israel in the nation of Egypt as they were slaves. But then God delivered them out on that Exodus night. And so the whole Old Testament is God giving Messiah to humanity. Who is Messiah? The anointed one. The seed. The seed that he was telling all the way back from the garden. And he kept talking about it through all of the prophets. He even said it in Deuteronomy chapter 18. There's going to be a prophet that arises from amongst the people. Amen. And God was going to fill his mouth with his words. He was talking about Jesus. And since then, there's been many prophets that have been to Israel. And they pointed back to Jesus. Whether it be Psalm 22, David as a prophet. They've pierced my hands. They've pierced my feet. Amen. And whether it be Isaiah, he bore our iniquities upon him. Like a lamb, he was silent. He was led to the slaughter. And time and again, God through the prophets spoke of the fact that Messiah was coming. God was bringing Messiah to humanity. You and I have the luxury to know and to believe. If you've ever believed this, then God lives in your heart. You know what I'm talking about. Amen. Sabrina and I were talking about it outside. Listen, ain't nobody in this place perfect, but let me tell you something. Sometimes this old world, it will beat you up. And this morning, the sun's shining, the sky is clear, and the air is crisp. Now, I got a little bit of a pep in my step, but I'm going to be honest with you. This world is still falling, and if I told you that you were going to have everything you wanted on this side, I'd be a lying preacher. But I will tell you one thing. Jesus is still on the throne. Hallelujah. And if you have invited him to live in your heart, you know what I'm talking about. He's real. Hallelujah. And there's something bigger than today to look forward to. Yeah. Amen. There's something bigger. I hope that I still got breath in my lungs tomorrow. But if I don't have breath in my lungs tomorrow, then I'm dancing on streets of gold. And I'm in the presence of the one that loved me and gave himself for me. Listen to me. Amen. Don't misinterpret what I'm saying, because I've been accused of that before too. Oh, you're teaching people not to worry about today. No, I'm not. Do what you're supposed to today.
Yeah.
If God lives in you, guess what? You're supposed to work harder than anybody else on the job. Did you know that? Yeah. Did you know that the book of Ephesians tells you how to work? That you're supposed to work not as though you're working for the man, but for the man. Hallelujah. You got a boss and he's watching the whole time. He's not over there wanting to beat you over the head. No, he's wanting you to give him glory with your life. When you start to work at your job like you're working for the master, because sometimes his name might roll off your lips. And if you're one of them old boys, don't tell. I worked in the oil field. I know what people do. They hide. They hide and they go find something to do downstairs. My daddy always told me, even though he didn't know Jesus, I hope he did at the end. I think he did at the end. But this one thing he told me about work, and it never made any sense to me. He'd say, boy, you don't run away from work, you run to it. When everybody else is running away from the nasty job, from the hard work. No, that's not what you do. You run to it and you get your hands up in it and you work. And you know what? You work because that's what we do. We work. And now, whenever I finally got Jesus in my heart, it made so much more sense. Amen. And listen, if you ever tried to have a business, this ain't got nothing to do with my message. The Lord's taking over. if you ever had to try to have your own business, listen to me. You better know it's the Lord. Don't do this in the flesh. I'm telling you right now. But listen, I tried to start a restaurant. I would use it as a learning experience, if nothing else. I work all day long as a nurse practitioner. Come back on Friday night. Guess who was washing dishes?
Yeah.
You know why? Because you can't keep a dishwasher. You know why? Because he's the lowest paid person and nobody wants to treat him right. And instead, everybody just piles all them dishes up. They're like, I'm out of here, dude. See ya. Somebody got to wash the dishes, right? And so here you are washing dishes. And so one of the things that I learned from that experience was this. Is that whenever it comes payroll time, I got to have some money in the bank to pay people. And guess what? I work for some people now. And in order for them to have money to pay me, they got to have money in the bank. The man ain't trying to hold you down. Yeah, you might be working for a greedy, evil person. That's between you and Jesus. The Lord may open up another door for you. But guess what? Until he opens up that other door, you need to work as unto the Lord at that place. And you need to realize that you're over there to try to be productive so that he would want you to stay, so that he has a way to give you a paycheck. I don't know who that's for, but that's Lanyap. Somebody in here needed to hear that this morning. You're working as unto the Lord. Amen. And if you've ever tried to own a business, you would be able to appreciate working harder for somebody else. Amen. At least that's what I've learned. All right.
Amen.
We're back to our story. God is trying to get Messiah. No, not trying. God's doing a very good job of getting Messiah to humanity. Amen. And in the New Testament, he's getting humanity to Messiah. Does that make sense? In other words, now the gospel's going forth. We're hearing the truth about Jesus. Whenever we believe it by faith, something changes on the inside of our lives, and now we're connected to Jesus. And this story still goes on. God's got one plan. And the point that I was trying to make a long time ago, and I probably lost you, was that's why we don't leave the cross. Because, see, it's the same plan for how you got saved that you walk in him. I didn't know. This is where I didn't know. This is what I want you to know, that I believe might distinguish us from making us a little bit different than a lot of the churches in the community. I'm not trying to say we better. That's not what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say that I think that this may be a little bit of a distinction. And I may be wrong. You go, if you want to go check them out, take some notes and get back with me, okay? If that's what you want to do. But what I want to say is this. This may be where the distinction lies. And it's not even all their fault. I believe that there's a lot of good churches, that a lot of people that love God, that want to know the truth. But the reality of it is that we're missing it somewhere. And I believe this is where we're missing it. And this is where I was missing it for 12 years as a Christian. It says in Colossians 2:6, and this is just one scripture that I'm giving you to make my point. I am not going to go through all the litany of scriptures, because that's not where we're going right now, okay? One scripture, Colossians 2:6. The same way you received him, so shall you continue to walk in him. How did you receive him?
By faith.
Yeah, because you didn't receive him by all the stuff you did, right? Okay. You didn't receive him by joining children, by taking over the children's church, or by coming to Sunday school, or by coming to three services a week, or by praying 5 hours in the morning, or by reading more Bible in the church than anybody else, or by wearing clothes that, you know, were more appropriate than the person next to you, or by quitting drinking, or by quitting doing drugs. That's not how you receive Jesus. No, the way you receive Jesus is you heard the gospel. You came to the realization, listen to me, if the gospel that was preached to you didn't make you recognize you were a sinner in need of a Savior, I question whether you got saved. I'm not the Holy Spirit. I'm not the final judge on it. But I'm just telling you that until the heart is broken and it realizes what manner of a man that it is, and that it needs Jesus and his blood that was shed, you can't get saved. So the way that you got saved was, the way you received him was through faith. Through faith in what? Faith in the seed and the sacrifice. You didn't have to know all that. But whenever I was in that church in Berwick and Sister Toot was preaching, and she said, she kept talking about the blood. Oh, I love telling this testimony. I told that testimony 4 times last week. She kept talking about the blood, and I was feeling all weird in the church, dude. I had my long hair. I just got out of Van Halen concert over there. Man, dude, why she keep talking about the blood? It's making me feel weird. I hate it. Nobody else knew that was going on, but that's what was going on. I was having all kind of stuff going on the inside of me. And all of a sudden she said it. The innocent one had to die in place of the guilty one. And when she said guilty, bam! Oh, the Holy Ghost started stimulating my heart, and I realized she was talking to me. And then how dare she? She stopped in the middle of what she was doing, and she said, the Holy Spirit's dealing with somebody in here. You better get up here and give your life to Jesus. I was like, man, she didn't have to tell me twice. I don't know. Look, back then you didn't have no pride. When the preacher preached, you came up there, and I ran up there. Oh, and I bowed my knees. Oh, I'm a sinner, Lord. And look, you know what a miracle happened when I stood up? Guess what happened? Like 2 cement sacks that I had been toting around all of my life. 100-pound sacks.
Thank you, Jesus.
Fell off. Fell off. The psychologist can't do that for you. Kuzak can't do that for you. Xanax can't do that for you. Jesus. Hallelujah. The righteous one. He's the only one that can unload the burden off of you.
Yes.
And when that happens,
Amen.
You know you're saved.
Amen.
It don't mean you're perfect.
Amen.
But this is the thing. This is where the distinction comes in. The same way you received him, so shall you continue to walk in him. What do you mean? Through faith? Through faith in what? Through faith in what God's plan is. That when you put your faith in the seed and the sacrifice, the righteousness of God, oh, this is good, is now given to you. You put faith in God's plan, he reciprocates by giving you righteousness, which allows grace to flow in your life.
Amen.
Now you got somebody working for you.
Amen.
You see, before Matt was trying to hunker down, oh, he's such a mess that we got to send him to this program over here. Cypress Hospital when he was 16. Lord, they needed to do something with me because I was a mess. That was when the first had the first rehab in the state of Louisiana, I think. God only knows how much money we wasted on that deal. Lord, forgive me. The next one was Greenville Springs Hospital. Oh, we really got to do something now. Oh, Lord, help him. He's running around when he's 17 years old, running around with a 27-year-old woman and all jacked up on all kind of stuff. What are we going to do with this boy? I'm just being real with you. I was messed up. But God changes people, amen? That didn't work. Next thing you know, send him to Briscoe in Lake Charles. Surely that'll fix him. And then detention home in between. And like I told you before, and I'll tell you again, each and every time, locked up, isolated, somebody willingly came in there and said, hey, you want to hear about the Bible? And whenever they would tell me about the Bible, I knew that there was truth there because my sister had already told me about the Bible, and I'd already actually asked Jesus to come into my heart. And if nothing else, at least a seed was planted. But the point that I'm trying to make is this. All that stuff wasn't working. The works of man's hands, his attempt through his program, through his psychology, cannot unload the cement sack off your back. The only thing that can do the work and allow grace to flow is persistent, proper faith in God's plan, which is the finished work of Jesus, where he broke the back of sin, where he destroyed principalities and powers, where he took the victory, hallelujah, from the enemy, because now the debt of sin no longer lingers over your head like a dark, ominous cloud, but instead you've been made free by the blood of the Lamb. So the same way you received him through faith is the same way each and every day you continue to walk in him. You know what that does? It causes you to realize you're dependent.
Amen.
On something other than yourself.
Ooh, yes.
Oh, some people don't like that preaching. I'm telling you right now, the flesh will just cringe when it's full of self-righteousness. When that spirit of the Pharisee lies upon a believer, it cringes him. Because they want to do their own works. They want to be recognized for what they do rather than giving. They don't realize it. If you said it to them and you said, hey, man, you're trying to take the glory for yourself, they'd say, you're a fool. But the reality of it is that that's what happens. All right, let's get to the passage of Scripture. We'll see how far the Lord will let us get in here. I think that it all ties together what God just did. Amen. I hope he'll tie it together more. In chapter 23, verse 1, Matthew, it says, then spoke Jesus to the multitude. I'm just going to try to explain some of this as we go. Then spoke Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples. Let me just say this too, real quick. I know there's a lot of modern translations now. And I use the King James Version. And I just want to tell you why I use the King James Version. If you're taking notes, you can write it down. A Lamp in the Dark, 2-part video series, 6 hours. It'll explain to you why I use it. It has to do with the manuscripts. But anyway, a lamp in the dark if you're interested. All right. Then spoke Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. In other words, essentially there was supposedly, according to scholars, a stone seat. And they would have put it on an elevated place. And the lead Pharisee would sit up in this seat. And all the people would come to him. And you need to come to me to get all of your wisdom. And so I'm in an elevated place and I'm sitting in Moses' seat. And you need to come hear the wisdom that comes out of me. And so essentially what's happening is the Pharisees are seated upon almost like a throne. And they put themselves in an elevated position because, once again, they're full of spiritual pride. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do, but do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. In other words, whenever they start talking to you about the law and explaining to you about the law, yeah, you're supposed to do that as best you can right now because he hadn't gone to the cross
yet.
But don't do what they do because they say things, but then they don't do it. Amen? All right. It says, all therefore, verse 4, for they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like even in the modern church, you know, if I was to sit here and tell you, and I don't do this, because you know what, if I got to try to twist your arm to come to church, I'm going to have to try to twist your arm to keep you in church, and dude, I ain't about that. And I got enough energy that I got to expend in other places, and I ain't going to sit here and beg. Now, if I find out that you need some help, I'm going to call you up, I'm going to pray with you, and if you still don't come, maybe I'm wrong on this ballot. I know Sister Tip would have went and rounded them up. And you know what, Lord? Speak to me if that's what I need to do. But it's like, if I got to beg you to stay, to come, I'm going to probably have to beg you to stay. All right? But the point that I'm trying to make is this. Is that, you know, a grievous burden could possibly be, if you don't come to church 3 times a week, you're not living right for God. I don't know what you got going on in your life. You know what I'm saying? I want you in church. You know how silly I'll look if you don't show up? You understand what I'm getting at? I want you in church, but if I tell you that if you don't come to church 3 times a week, that you're not right with God, I'm a lying preacher. I'm not going to put a heavy burden on your back. The way that you get right with God is by putting your faith in Christ. But I will admit that whenever we feel the love of God changing our lives and He causes those cement sacks to fall off our back, there's something in us that wants to be around the things of God. Now, I can assure you that the enemy of your soul will try to fight you tooth and nail to keep you out of being in fellowship with the brethren. Amen? Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Okay. Oh, yeah. Amen.
All right. So anyway, I'm just trying to cross the bridge on that deal to show you what Jesus was saying to them and how that may apply to our lives today. Verse 5. But all their works they do for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries, like a little box they put on their head. They put some scripture in it and enlarge the borders of their garments. So here they are. They're full of religious works and they're wanting to do it. They sit in the seat. They walk around with scriptures so that people can see them, how holy they are. And you ever seen Christians like that before? I hope that's not you. I know I've been like that before. Christians that they just want you to know all the stuff they do. And Lord, I know I've done that before. Lord, forgive me as I preach. You know, it's like, you know, oh, look at all this stuff I do for the kid. Now, sometimes it's a testimony, right? And we're just really trying to give glory to God. But sometimes it's not. We're puffed up with pride. Same spirit that was on them can also jump on Christians. They love the uppermost rooms at feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues and greetings in the markets and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi. Oh, great one. Oh, great teacher. But be not ye called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father, which is in heaven. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. And you know the word Christ also is the Greek version of the word Messiah, and it means the anointed one. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. Now, did you hear that? Jesus is speaking kingdom message right here. Mm-hmm. And what he's letting us know is this. Is that when you lower yourself, you're elevated in the eyes of God. God honors that. When we lower ourselves and we take the position of humility. Let me say this. I want to make this point clear because it doesn't make any sense to the logical mind. And it's really important that we understand this. I'm telling you, there's something really supernatural that takes place when this happens. Just as it doesn't make any sense for some long-haired dude that's been in 5 different or however many places I was to run up to an altar on his knees and to say the name Jesus, but yet to stand up and all of a sudden cement sacks fall off his back, it makes about as much sense in the logical mind for what I'm about to tell you. That there are times in your life, some of you know what I'm talking about because we had conversations about it. There will be times in your life when there will be people that come against you, whenever there will be things that are coming against you, and you have every right to take vengeance or to defend yourself in whatever way, shape, or form because you are being hurt. And yet the Holy Spirit is nudging you in your spirit. He's saying, humble yourself. Humble yourself. Let me have this. Let me prove myself to you. And I'm telling you, it's the most painful thing sometimes. I mean, it's like it's just stretching everything that's in you. And if you can't hear the voice of God at all because you're just so busy in your own, and I've been there before, like, I don't know, I'm about to take care of this, bro. I'm about to fix this situation. Look, I just tried to do it a couple weeks ago. I'm about to confront this and fix this. And you know what the Lord said? Okay, have at it, big boy. Have your way. And what ends up happening, though, is that when we take that place of humility, it's like the Holy Spirit comes in. And he starts doing the work. And he starts fixing things and knitting things and mending broken bones and putting medicine in places that stuff's infected. And the next thing you know, he starts doing supernatural work. Hallelujah. Because that's what God does. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're trying to fix in your own strength. But I really believe that God wanted me to say that to somebody here today. Listen, submit yourself under the hand of God. Lower yourself in the eyes of God. And sometimes that means also lowering yourself in the eyes of man. I'm going to tell you a story one time. I left the church one time. The Lord had gotten a hold of me, man. I was learning the Word of God like you just wouldn't even believe. And the Lord wanted me to go talk to this preacher. And I went and I talked to the preacher. And the Lord wanted me to say some things. And I did everything I felt like the Lord wanted me to do. And then I was released to go where I was going. And about 3 weeks later, at the new church I was going to, there were some people that had also left their church. And I saw them in Kukos. I said, yeah, man, I left that church, man. I went in there and I told that preacher, blah, 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 blah. And when I was driving home, he said, you told the preacher? Who do you think you are? The Lord began to chastise me. I'm talking about he took me to the woodshed. Next morning, dude, I was like, oh, Lord, please forgive me, Lord. And I'm telling you, my heart was broken. Right, I was soft. I was soft at that point before the Lord. And I'm like, Lord, please forgive me. And then the next day, I was studying again. He's like, oh, okay. You took care of half your business. Now I need you to do the rest. I knew what he wanted. He said, you want that monkey off your back? I'm like, oh, Lord, he wants me to call that preacher up. But that preacher don't even know. Mm-hmm. I told somebody that was close to me, I said, man, I think this is what the Lord wants me to do. He's like, no, dude, that ain't God, bro. There ain't no reason to do that. It doesn't make any sense. He'll never know. Couldn't get it off. Couldn't shake it. I had to call. I called and I said it. And you know what? I mean, yeah, the guy invited me back to church. The Lord had told me not to go back to that church. That wasn't the issue. God was trying to do something. He was trying to get me to lower myself.
Amen.
So that he could work in me. Do you realize that we spend the majority of our time elevating ourselves and trying to puff ourselves up, and the Lord's trying to break us down? Amen. Not because he wants to beat us up and tear us up, because he can't. God cannot work with pride. Do you realize that? He says, I resist the proud, but I give grace to the humble. Humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that in due time I might exalt thee. Listen, Satan, it's pride that tried to elevate him above the throne of God. God will not deal with pride. He resists it. It's like two polar sides of a magnet. Every time they try to come together, God's resistant towards that. I'm not having fellowship with that spirit. Humble yourself. That's come good. Unto me like a little child and humble yourself. Amen?
Amen.
Pharisees, I can tell you that they didn't know anything about humble. It says right here in verse 12. Remember, our message is, I can't see myself. And it says in verse 12, and whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. Verse 13. But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in. In other words, Jesus is trying to tell them what the real kingdom is, and he is the real kingdom.
Amen.
And people are coming to him, and the Pharisees, in their religious spirit, are trying to prevent the people from going to Jesus. Don't ever tell me that Jesus was all docile and never confronted false religion, because he just called them, he says, hypocrites, is what he called them right there. Verse 14, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer, therefore you shall receive the greater damnation. In other words, you're over here doing this to these people, and then you're over here all holy and praying. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not trying to make fun, but I heard a preacher say one time, he said, okay, son, you're gonna say great, you're gonna pray over the food, and dude started just like really praying. I mean, like, Lord, you know, and I mean, you know what? You gotta appreciate that. I would never tell anybody that if they're praying like that. But he's like, son, I'm hungry. If you need to practice your prayer time, you need to get in the closet. But the point is, sometimes people are just genuinely on fire for the Lord. But there is the truth that people are trying to live holy in the presence of other people. Amen. And we got to be able to discern the difference, because sometimes we may think somebody's trying to be holy, but the reality of it is, they're just really on fire for Jesus. And I mean, look, I know that I come across the wrong way a lot of times, but I can tell you that whenever I gave my heart to the Lord at the church that I used to go to, And the Lord just overwhelmed me. I'm talking about one week, I'm talking about football players, how high they can jump, how fast they can run, how much weight they can lift, how far, how accurate their passing percentage is. And the next week, I'm talking about Jesus, the darling of heaven, the lover of my soul. And I remember this dude saying, "Dude, what's this all about?" I'm like, "What's it all about?" Oh, he opened my eyes, man. I was blind. I was walking around with blinders for 12 years. I thought I was okay, and I wasn't. I was a bound up religious. I can't even tell you the things I did whenever the lights were out. I would be embarrassed to tell you as a Christian the things that I did when the lights were out, when nobody else was looking. But that's what I was doing. And look, and he opened my eyes. He let me see. Hallelujah. Freedom. He gave me. How could I not talk about him? How could I not tell people about this Jesus that will set the captive free? That was after being a Christian for 12 years. So some semen fell off that day too. Amen. Yeah. All right. He goes on to say in verse 15. "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you compass the sea and land to make one proselyte." In other words, you're getting a boat, travel all over to make one convert. That's what the word proselyte is. "And when he is made, you make him twofold the child of hell than yourselves." In other words, whenever people are full of religion and they teach converts their form of religion, they produce the same kind of thing. It's a spirit of religion. You go to some churches and you'll see exactly that. The preacher has a spirit of religion behind him. He is he leads from a position of self-righteousness. And the whole congregation, for the most part, is going to be also self-righteous. They think that they're better than everybody else. Amen. And the reality of it is that it's a spirit of religion that is on them.
Amen. That's good.
And you know what? It's harder to break a spirit of religion than it is a spirit of addiction.
Yeah.
I'm telling you right now, the person who is bound by alcohol or crack can be set free so much faster than the person that's bound by a spirit of religion.
Amen.
Because the person that's bound by a spirit of religion, he doesn't think anything's wrong with him. I can't see myself because he's bound like these Pharisees by a spirit that prevents him. Look what he says right here. He says in verse 16, "Woe unto you blind guides, which say, whosoever shall swear by the temple, it is nothing, but whosoever shall swear by the gold of the temple, he is a debtor." Verse 17, "You fools and blind, for whether is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold?" You know what he's saying? He's saying, "You Pharisees, you're a bunch of blind guides. You say, well, I'm going to swear an oath. I swear to you an oath by the temple." Now, an oath is binding when you swear in the Old Testament. "I swear to you an oath that I will do this thing according to the temple." But then whenever it wasn't something that I really didn't want to do, it's like, I tricked you. Because I didn't swear by the altar that was in the temple.
Oh.
Or I didn't swear by I swore by the altar, but I didn't swear by the gift that was on the altar. Ha ha, I gotcha. Now, not that they're going to say that, but that's what they were doing. They were breaking the oath because they said, "Yeah, I might have swore by the temple, but I didn't swear by the altar. I might have swore by the altar, but I didn't swear by the gift, but by the gift that was on the altar." Jesus is like, "What are you doing? The temple represents the house of God. The temple represents the place that God sits. The throne of God is in the temple. His presence is there. When you're making an oath, you're making the oath to God, not to an altar, to a gift. But you're blind. You're blinded by your own self-righteousness. You're over here picking apart these different aspects having to do with the law, and you can't even see yourselves." He goes on to say, we can keep on reading. He says, "You tithe cumin and mint." Meaning, you know what? There's like little spices. You know what a tithe is? It's a tenth. So if you add like a little thing of cumin, you make chili before, I think you're supposed to put cumin in chili. It's like you take a little tenth of that and you give a tithe of it. You see that? And don't think that they're just going to do it in their house. Oh no, they're going to do it where everybody can see. Like, I'm tithing my cumin. I want you to see what I'm doing, man. I'm doing this all for God. And it's like people are like, "Oh man, look how holy they are."
Uh-huh.
And Jesus is like, "You're not looking at the inside of what's going on here. You should have done that, yes. Okay, pay your tithes on all that you get. Hallelujah. But you should have paid attention to the weightier matters of the law," which was trying to talk about what's going on the inside. He ends up getting into that if you go down to verse 24. He says, "You blind guides, you strain at a gnat and swallow a camel." See, a gnat, if it fell in a cup of liquid, would make the whole liquid unclean. So they're over there straining the gnat out. to get it out. And he says, then you swallow a camel. A camel was an unclean animal. In other words, he's using hyperbolic language. He's inflating the situation to show him this is what your heart looks like. You're trying to straighten a gnat, but you're eating an unclean camel. And the reality of it is that you are so full of uncleanness. And he's talking to the religious here. He goes on to say, in verse 26, you blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. So what he's trying to say is this. See, I can tell you that if we interpret this properly, Jesus is saying, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the kingdom of God come upon you. And there's a transition that's taking place. You ever heard how people sometimes in the modern church are like, God's doing a new thing. And they're talking about the way that they do their modern church. God ain't doing a new thing. God's already done a new thing. Yeah. God did a new thing when he changed covenants and he gave us Jesus. The next new thing on the horizon, he's taking the church out of here.
Amen.
And in the meantime, God is doing the same thing that he's doing. He's leading people to Jesus. Amen. Amen. And I'm not trying to pick on everything that everybody's doing. Sometimes maybe I'm critical in that. But the reality of it is this, is that we need to make sure that we're staying close to the gospel because this has not changed. Amen.
Amen.
And he goes on to say right here, verse 27. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You know what a hypocrite is, right? It's like an actor on a stage with a mask. You're acting one way, but in reality, you're doing something else. Now let's make this clear, because we're probably going to get into some of this stuff here in a second. Some people would say, don't judge. Have you ever seen people now that they got tattoos on there? I can't help myself. It's that only God can judge me. And it's like when I see that, I'm like, dude, can we talk about your tattoo for just a second? Because I got to tell you something. He is going to judge you. I mean, I'm not trying to be rude. I'm trying to say, like, if I didn't love you, I wouldn't tell you. Do you have Jesus in your heart? Because if you don't have Jesus in your heart, he's going to judge you. Now, this is the thing. Is that judgmental for me to say that to him? To some people, they may think so. Some people might say, dude, you're judgmental. You think you're right. I'm either telling you the truth or I'm not. If you don't embrace Jesus, you're going to be judged by God. And you're going to stand naked before him because you were clothed with his righteousness. Come on, somebody. And all things are open in his sight. And you will be judged. So this is the thing. It's not that we're not ever supposed to point things out that aren't right. And even though, but what about you, preacher? Are you perfect? Of course I'm not perfect. I'm a human being. The word of God is the word of God. If it was dependent upon me to be perfect, to be able to preach the truth or to tell people the truth, then we would never speak truth on this earth because nobody's worthy to speak it. Why God chose the foolishness of preaching to confound the wise, I don't know, but that's what he did. But this is the thing, we're talking about motives, folks. What are the motives of the heart?
Yes.
I'm not going to turn there, but it says, I believe it's 1 Corinthians 8:1. He was talking about people sitting down at the table to eat meat. And he was talking about how people were judging them. Because you see, back then in Corinth, they would offer sacrifices to idols or demons. And then they would eat the meat. I told you that story, right, about that person I worked with before. And they were going in the woods and putting their hands on the goat and all that stuff. And they believe in transference of spirits. It happens. That's how they practice black magic. And they eat the meat of the goat and they get demon spirits in them. And so, but what was happening is that there were people in the church that had been convicted of that. And when they saw other people that would still eat in the temple, they were looking down on them. Oh, man, you still eat at the table with devils. What's wrong with you? Now, Paul makes it clear in another spot. He's like, if you know good and well that they've offered that meat up as a sacrifice to a devil, then you ought not be eating that meat. Because that meat's been offered to the devil and you can't eat at the Lord's table and also at that. But then he turns around and he's telling these people, because it would look like he's contradicting himself. No, that's not what he's doing. He's turning around and he's telling these other people, knowledge puffs up. He said, you got all this knowledge because you're from Corinth and you know all this stuff. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? It's the word in the Greek for building a house. Whenever the true love of Christ comes on the inside of your heart, and you share the truth with somebody, the reason that you're doing it is being motivated because you are literally concerned about their soul. Mm-hmm. I try to tell that to some people whenever I get in heated discussions with them. I'm like, dude, I love you. I love your... They're like, you love me? Yeah, dude, I love you. I love your soul. That's why I say this. And if it wouldn't be for that, I ain't got time for this. I mean, I'll tell them that, but that's what I'm thinking. I ain't got time for this, dude. I got other stuff to do. I love your soul. That's why I'm going to take the time to tell you. It's motivated by love. It may not come out that way. Yeah. You know, people may take me wrong. Lord, help me work on my presentation. But it's because of the love of Jesus that I believe that they got to get a hold of the truth.
Amen.
And so it's like, don't say that we can't judge things because there's right and there's wrong.
That's right.
And the truth has to be told. The question is, what are the motives of our heart?
Amen.
Do we have the spirit of the Pharisees? And we're over here trying to nitpick everybody apart. Oh, you got this wrong in your life. You got that wrong in your life. Yeah, you still looking at stuff on the computer. Well, okay, well, you don't have that problem, right? But what problem do you have? Is my point. And even though you have a problem in your life, it doesn't mean you can't speak truth into somebody. It just needs to be coming from the spirit of love. Amen. From the love of Jesus. And it doesn't mean that even the spirit of love doesn't ever raise its voice. Jesus is over here. Woe unto you, hypocrites. And don't think that he didn't care about their soul either. Right. Well, how do I know that? Because he hung on the cross. And he said, Father, forgive them. For they know not what they do after they've sold me into these lies, and they hung me on this cross, and they ripped the beard from my face. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Jesus had a heart of compassion.
Yes.
And he laid his life down. Amen?
Yeah.
And so basically, though, what he's talking about is the inside. That's where I went off on that little rabbit trail. Because he said, woe unto you scribes and Pharisees. In verse 27, he says, you're like whited sepulchres. It's another word for a tomb. You paint the tomb white, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly. Oh, look at that beautiful white tomb. It's all pretty and whitewashed and clean. But are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within you are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. And so, this is how they're walking around. They're walking around with a spirit of religion that makes them, they can so clearly see everybody else's issues, but they can't see what's going on in themselves, and they think that they're perfectly right. Okay, also in Matthew chapter 7, there's a similar type passage of scripture that it talks about right here, and I think that this will help further solidify one of the other points that I wanted to make. In Matthew 7, verses 1, see where it says right here, this is where we can get confused sometimes, because trust me, people have thrown this one out on me. Judge not that ye be not judged. Don't judge me, dude. Only God can judge me. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. And with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. So what he's saying is that how you mete out your judgment is the way you're going to be judged.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he goes on to explain a couple of things right here in these next couple of verses. And if you really look at it close, you realize he's not saying don't judge anything. He's saying it needs to be done from the wrong perspective. If the title of the message is I Can't See Myself, what Jesus is trying to say to us is this: take a look at yourself also first, so that you might be able to help somebody else. Amen?
Amen.
Says in verse 3, and why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye? That's King James Version, for it describes like a piece of chaff. You know what chaff is? You remember the wheat, when they would do the wheat harvest, they'd have a big old pile of wheat, and they'd get like a pitchfork or a winnowing fan, is what they called it. And they'd take a scoop of that, and they'd throw it up in the air, and the wind would blow the chaff off. And the best way I could describe chaff, you ever ate peanuts before? Like the kind that you crack out of the thing, and it's got that little layer of that skin around it, and how it kind of crumbles up and breaks up. Grain has an even smaller one like that on it, and it kind of crumbles off. So it's kind of like in this parable type situation, somebody got a piece of that chaff in their eye, and it's a little bitty speck, right? And it's in there. Now, that can be really irritating, and they need some help. They need to get that out, because it's not conducive to them walking right, seeing right. Come on, somebody. I'm talking spiritual stuff. You want to be able to see stuff spiritually. You want to be able to walk right in the kingdom of God. Amen. And Jesus says, why are you looking or beholdest thou the chaff that is in your brother's eye, but you consider not the beam that is in your own eye? You got a timber in your eye, sir. A timber is a big old piece of wood that's used to hold up a structure. You're over here looking at the chaff in this old boy's eye, and you got like a timber in your own eye. See, it's the motives. It's the motives of the heart. They aren't right. You're judging down on somebody. You got your own sin in your own life, but at the same time, because your sin isn't their sin, you elevate yourself and you look down on them. That's called relative righteousness. That's self-righteousness. That goes nowhere in the kingdom of God. And you know what? If we're being honest with one another, we've all done this. Come on, somebody. Help me out here. Help out the preacher. We've all done this. We've all judged other people. Well, I don't like the way they do this. And I don't like, well, guess what? The Lord don't like the way you do some stuff.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? I'm just being real. Amen. All right. It says right here, verse 4, or how will you say to your brother, let me pull out that chaff or that mote out of your eye, and behold, a beam is in your own eye. You can't see right to do that. You're going to pull eye surgery on somebody and you can't even see. Verse 5, you hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of your own eye, and then you shall see clearly to cast out the mote out of your brother's eye. In other words, Jesus agrees, yep, the mote needs to come out. The chaff needs to come out that old boy's eye because he can't see right. It's irritating him. It's messing him up. But you ain't the one right now in the condition that you are that's going to sit there and judge down on this person. All I'm getting this point across, it's about the motive of the heart. Amen? Whatever Jesus told them a little while ago, he said, you clean the outside of the cup, but the inside's full of uncleanness. He said, you whitewash the tombs, but the inside's full of dead men's bones. You understand that in the new covenant, God promised, even in the Old Testament, in Jeremiah 31:31, and also in Ezekiel 36:25-27, that in the new covenant, that there was a new thing that's going to be done. And in the new thing, what was going to happen is his spirit was going to come live in the heart of man. He said in Jeremiah 31:31, he said, I'm going to make a new covenant with my people. And in this covenant, I'm going to write my law on the inside of their hearts. My law is no longer going to be written by a finger on stone, but instead my law now is going to be written in your heart. Long before you ever did it, you knew the Holy Spirit showed you you weren't supposed to go there. Right? Grace will hold you more accountable than the law ever could. Because when you really have a relationship with Jesus, the Holy Spirit's dealing with you. He's contending with you. It's not a letter of the law. People flipping through the scriptures. You know, look, I ain't picking on nobody. If y'all know my story, y'all know good. I'm about to talk about smoking. Like, you ain't supposed to ever talk about smoking in the church anymore. Come on, somebody. Give me a break. Okay? I'm being real with you. For 12 years as a Christian, I shoved a can and a half of dip in my lip. Okay? I'm not judging anybody. I'm just trying to say, if you really saved and you're addicted to nicotine, then you know good and well that the Lord wants you to get free from that. Amen. Amen. I don't even know what I was going to say now. I was trying to correct myself and make everybody happy and messed it up. But the point that I was trying to make was this, is that, you know what, we look down on people, but it's not that we're not supposed to say the truth. Amen. God wants to set us free. Mm-hmm. It wasn't Sister Took that was telling me I needed to quit dipping. It was every time I looked in the mirror and pulled my lip down and saw it all wrinkled up and a hole in it that I was going to die, and the condemnation that I was doing stuff I wasn't supposed to do that was telling me I wasn't right with God, that kept causing me to sling that stuff in the Gulf. And then 3 days later, I'm like, you got to send me some more out here. I'm dying out here. And then, you know what? Thank God that I finally got a hold of the truth that broke the chains of that stuff. Listen, there was a difference between the physical addiction and the spiritual addiction. There was a physical addiction that I had to get free physically from the nicotine. But I'm telling you, I had quit for a whole year before and didn't touch it, but I wasn't free spiritually. And every time I'd see somebody with some of that stuff in their lip, I was like, oh man. Now why? Last year when I looked at it all wrinkled up, I was freaking out. But now I'm like, oh man, there ain't nothing better than a dip right now. I mean, who in the world ever thought dip was that lovely anyway? But my point, I did. But then when I was free, I was sharing that with Troy the other day on the phone. When I was free from dip, you know, he's always freeing us up from stuff, amen? It ain't never going to stop. I walked up in that store, and I saw that stuff up on the counter, and the enemy said, look, there it is. Because somebody was buying one, the same stuff I used to do. And all of a sudden, it was like I laughed. I laughed out loud. Ah, And I started thinking, you're a lying devil. I've been set free from that by the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
Praise God. Somebody needed to hear that. But look, so the Lord wants us to know, amen, that there is freedom and that there's liberty and that there's a big difference between the spirit of religion and what true righteousness looks like. Amen. And that he wants us to be able to see ourselves. Thank you, Jesus. In John chapter 5, there was I'm about to close up. I give a lot of scripture and a lot of concepts.
Amen.
Whenever I preach. Amen. Thank you, sister. And sometimes people are like, man, I don't know if I'm used to his preaching style, but you know what? If you hang around with me a little bit, you know, then we'll get it. The Lord's going to help us figure it out. I'm going to get become a better preacher, and you're going to become a better listener. And it's going to get good. Amen. All right. It says in verse 33 of John chapter 5, we're going to start right there, but I want you to know that this is in the same chapter where, remember when Jesus healed that lame man? At the pool of Bethesda. Y'all remember that story? Mm-hmm. Said that man was lame for 38 years. And it says in the scripture that they would bring all manner of infirm to him. Blind, halt, withered. I wanted to point that out because the title of my message is I Can't See Myself. See, there were people also that couldn't see physically during the time frame of Jesus, but he healed them. The difference between them was that they were hungry for healing, and the Pharisees couldn't see spiritually because they weren't hungry for healing and they weren't hungry for the truth. Amen? I mean, you remember blind Bartimaeus, right? Son of David, have mercy on me. And the disciples were like, you be quiet, you little blind beggar. Stay over here on the side. There's no freedom for you. And he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. I heard that you can do it. Open my eyes, Lord. Please let me see. And I wish that we were that way spiritually. Lord, open our eyes that we might be able to see. And so anyway, they got all these lame people, blind people at the pool of Bethesda. Jesus heals that lame man, causes him to walk. Now the Pharisees are mad at him. Says right here in verse 33, Jesus is talking to the Pharisees. And in John 5:33, he says, you sit unto John and he bear witness unto the truth. If you go back and you read in John chapter 1, verses 19 through 30, I'm not going to go there. But basically what Jesus is reminding them, when John the Baptist was in the wilderness baptizing, you sent people over there to ask him questions. And what'd you ask him? Are you the Christ? Nope, I'm not the Christ. I'm bearing witness to the truth. I'm not him. Well, are you Elijah, that prophet? Nope, I'm not Elijah. Well, are you that prophet? Whenever I taught y'all Deuteronomy, I forgot to tell you a very important verse. In Deuteronomy 18:15, the Lord promised that he would rise up a prophet from amongst the people. So when the Pharisees said that in John chapter 1, are you that prophet? That's what he was talking about, the prophet from Deuteronomy. John about to say, nope, I'm not that prophet. Well, who are you then? He said, I'm a voice. Just like Isaiah the prophet said, I'm a voice in the wilderness, crying out, prepare ye the way of the Lord. I'm preparing the way of the Lord. And then he says this. He says, there's one who cometh after me, and I'm not worthy to loosen the latchet on his sandal. Amen? He was talking about, and then all of a sudden, this is what happens. In the Valley of Jordan, John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he whom I told you about, that I was unworthy and that he was preferred before me. And so John the Baptist just told them the whole gospel message. They sent Pharisees, they sent the people out there to question John the Baptist. Jesus says, you sent him out there, he told you the truth. And the truth that he told you was that I was the one. I was the long-awaited one, I was the Messiah. And this is what I've come to do. I am the Lamb of God, hallelujah, who came to take away the sin of the world. But the Pharisees don't want that.
No.
They want their religion. Listen to me, people that sit in modern churches, they don't want, oh Lord help me, I want to say it right. That's not even true. Most people are like a junkie in a bed looking for another fix to get free. I'm talking about pain, dude. I'm talking about people crawled up in their bed, all over, crying, snot coming out of their nose because they're bound up by something or they're hurting by something because, I don't know, relationship disaster, addiction problems, financial woes that sin has got, and and nobody else can see it, but they're hurting and they want to be free. And then they find themselves in the midst of a church that isn't going to tell the truth, that the problem with man still is the same today that it was here. inside. Amen. It starts changing things. It doesn't happen overnight, but it starts changing things. And that's what Jesus is saying. You said you wanted to know the truth, but you don't really want the truth.
That's right.
And unfortunately, there's people that are bound up in churches, and their preachers won't even tell them the truth. You know why? Because they're scared they're not going to come back next week.
Yeah.
How dare you, sir? Oh, they still got some preachers that watch these videos. How dare you, sir? How dare you hold back the truth of the gospel.
Amen.
Because you want to fill fannies in your seats.
Hmm.
Lord, help us. Lord, continue to take care of this church to where we can preach the truth.
Yes.
That's all I ask God to do. I ask God for a couple things. I'm going on a little too long now, but I ask God for a couple things. I told Ballard this before. I was walking up and down the sidewalk. I said, Lord, if you give us a church, please don't make me play music on my phone. I don't want to have to play music on my phone. I want live music in the church. Lord, please don't make me be a preacher with it. And well, you know what? Finally, the Lord had to deal with my heart. You either going to be a preacher without music, or you're just not going to be a preacher. What are you going to do? Okay, Lord, I'll do the phone thing. But Lord, I'm going to do the phone, but would you send some musicians? Lord, send some musicians. Send Ballard, send Mr. Paul. I told Ballard, we need more, right? Ballard's like, yeah, we need more. I'm praying, Lord, send some more musicians. Guess what? He's starting to send more musicians. I'm still praying that he'll send more. And I don't know about Ballard, but dude, the music sounded good to me. It's amazing. The bass and the drums will do the music. And as he keeps filling it, it's going to sound better and better. But hey, thank you, Jesus, for what you've given us. But continue to give us more, Lord. We know you want to bless the church. But you know what? The Lord got to work stuff out in Matt.
Amen.
Matt got pride issues. Is it okay if I tell y'all the truth?
Yes.
Hope y'all still love me when we're done here. I'm just trying to be real with you. I don't want to play music on my phone, Lord. I can hear the Lord now, you little crybaby. Just do what I've called you to do. Quit crying. You want to be a leader? You want to preach the gospel? Preach the gospel. Amen? All right.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. All right. We're getting off track here. All right, it says right here, verse 34, but I receive not testimony from man, but these things I say, that you might be saved. He, talking about John, was a burning and a shining light, and you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John, for the works which the Father has given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me, that the Father has sent me, and the Father himself, which hath sent me, has borne witness of me. You have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape, and you have not his word abiding in you. Boy, that's some strong words, huh? For whom he has sent, him you believe not.
Mm-hmm.
This is the real part I wanted you to see right here, because you remember we're saying I can't see. The Pharisees have a spirit on them that has blinded them. Remember how many times he called them blind? He called them blind 5 times. Blind guides, blind hypocrites, over and over again. Because they could not see the condition of their own hearts. They were full of self-righteous religion, and they couldn't see. It says right here in verse 39, search the scriptures. Jesus is saying, go ahead, get out your scroll. I know you've been doing it. You search the scriptures all day long. That's all you do. You put it in a box on your forehead. You're so holy. Everybody sees it. I know I'm adding some stuff, but he's being pretty rough to them right here. Search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me. And you will not come to me that you might have life. Once again, Jesus is basically preaching, or he's saying the same thing I told y'all in the beginning of this message, the seed and the sacrifice. It was all written right there. They knew it better than anybody. They read it. They memorized it. They had this stuff memorized. He's saying, search the scriptures. You think you're going to find eternal life in them? But they're pointing you to me, and you refuse to come to me. The point that I'm trying to make is this. When the true gospel hits our hearts, and the Holy Spirit comes to live in our lives, when we really begin to see the gospel, it begins to change us. Amen. We get filled with the love of Christ, where instead of judging downward on people, we're wanting to see them see the love of God that can also change their lives. Amen?
Amen.
If you got your Bibles, I got just maybe one more scripture that I'd like to share with you. Exodus chapter 38, verse 8. Now, I've shared this passage of scripture with the congregation before, but I think it's powerful. And it kind of goes along with what Ballard preached a while back about the Word of God and what it does in our lives. In Exodus 38, verse 8, it says, I still hear the leaves of books turning, so we'll wait a second. Exodus 38, verse 8. It says, and he made a laver. some translations would call it a wash basin. He made a laver of brass, and the foot of it brass, and of the looking glasses of the women assembling, which assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. Now, what I want you to see there is that word looking glasses. In reality, maybe a better translation for that would be reflection mirrors, because they didn't have glass back then or mirrors back then. But what it's talking about is reflecting metal that the women would use to look at themselves. All right, so what is the labor? The labor is the wash basin. When you walk into, I don't want to get out of the camera, but like whenever you walk into the tabernacle, there's the altar of sacrifice. And we've said this before, you can't get any further in the presence of God till you do business at the altar of sacrifice, because it represents the cross. If you're going to get into the presence of God, your sin has to be dealt with at the cross. Amen? When you go past the altar of sacrifice, there's the bronze laver. It was full of water. The bottom of it was made out of the looking glasses or the reflective mirrors of the women. So what ends up happening is that just as the word of God, you see, the altar of sacrifice is representative of the cross, the laver is representative of the word of God. And what would happen is this, is that the priest would get down there at the laver and he would look into the water, and guess what he would see?
The blood.
He would see himself, right?
Yeah.
But many times what he would see upon himself was the blood of the sacrifice. So he has to come to grips with the reflection that he sees. And what he sees is two things. And this is what the Word of God will always show you repetitively. It will always show you other things. But one of the things that the Word of God wants to do is, and we got one more scripture after this, so just bear with me. The Word of God always wants to do this. It wants to show you at least two things. It wants to show you yourself, and it wants to show you the work of God.
Mm-hmm.
Because it never wants to leave you where you are. You know that?
Yeah.
That's one beautiful thing about the gospel, and you won't ever hear this preacher preach that way, where I'm just going to sit here and pound sin and leave you high and dry and say, okay, go eat your chicken. Because no, because you can't leave people beat up without an answer. Because Lord, if he don't give us an answer, we in the whole world are hurting. Amen?
Amen.
And the truth of the matter is that when that man would look into that reflection, he would see that blood splattered all over him, and he would realize, even going all the way back to that Passover night, 400 or 500 years before that, it required the shedding of blood to pay the penalty of man's sin. And I see the gravity of sin, and it's all over me. Oh, but the blood. At the same time, it's the blood of the Lamb, and it's that which was shed that allows me to have access to God. And when you turn the leaves of this book, it ain't supposed to be elevating you to a place like a Pharisee, to where you're like, I read 5 chapters today and I bet that old boy over there, he ain't even cracked his Bible open in a week. No, that's not what it's supposed to do to you. It's supposed to show you yourself.
Amen.
I can't see myself, Lord. Well, guess what? Go into the Word of God with the right spirit and let the Word of God have its way in you. As a matter of fact, this is what we're going to close with. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. One of my favorite passages of scriptures in the Bible. I know the Lord's already given Ballard a song for us to close with. Praise God. All right. It says right here in Hebrews 4, verse 12. For the word of God is quick. I've shared with you before, that word is King James for alive. The word of God is alive. And it's powerful. And it's sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and the marrow. Now you realize what's being said here. I don't really have time to get into a teaching on the soul and the spirit. But what we need to understand is this. The soul and the spirit are not exactly the same. Yet at the same time, they're intricately woven together. So close. And they make up the inner man. Alright? But they're not the same. Because if they were exactly the same, then the word of God couldn't separate them. It's almost like I heard one preacher say one time, it's like a wheel. You got a tire and a rim. If you take one of the pieces out, you don't have a whole wheel anymore. One of them would represent the soul, one of them would represent the spirit, but the two of them function together in one unit as the inner man. Amen? But what the Word of God can do is, it's alive. It can reach down up in there and it can split the two apart. And what that means is, see, many times your soul, that's how you engage your world, your soul craves things. There's things about you, things that you want, and the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, showing you, the part of you that's alive to God is showing you, no, the God in you saying that your soul is craving something that's not right. Amen? And so the Word of God can reach deep down in there, and it can begin to separate the soul from the spirit, begin to reveal to you. Look what it also says. It says that it divides asunder soul and spirit, And it uses this as an analogy, joints and marrow. Do you realize that the marrow is inside the bone? You know how hard it is to get marrow out of a bone? Look, we don't want to talk about it. It's rough, okay? I've seen it at the bedside. It hurts. All right? Then it goes on to say this, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. The Word of God, when it's put on the inside of you, will reveal to you the very intents of your heart. Then it goes on to say this, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. The God we serve, he sees real clearly. Tonight, this morning, we might be preaching a message. I brought this mirror up here because I was going to say, I see a room full of people that used to be bound by this and bound like that. And I brought a mirror. I stopped over there. I forgot to use my mirror this morning. Just to say, don't worry, I'm looking at myself too, because I know that guess what? I'm messed up too, and I want to be able to see myself. Amen. We need to be able to see ourselves. Lord, let the Word of God speak to us. Let it reveal your truth to us. Amen. I hope that you got the essence of my message.